We've all heard white noise through our speakers, and we've all seen it on TV screens.
But have you ever heard of pink noise? Not on your TV, although you may just need to adjust your color temperature if you're seeing pink noise there. But have you ever heard pink noise? All throughout the audio production world, pink noise is frequently used, and in this video, you'll learn why it's so useful. But let's back up for a moment and answer the question, how can noise we don't see be pink? You may know that the color white is a combination of all colors. The same is true for white noise in audio. White noise has equal intensity across all frequencies. If you were to look at white noise on a frequency graph, it would look like this. Equal energy on the y-axis across all frequencies on the x-axis. And here's how it sounds. Okay, if the color white contains all colors, what would happen if we added in one of the lowest frequency colors that humans can see? Red. It would turn pink, right? Pink noise is similar because it contains more low frequency energy compared to white noise. The reason pink noise has more low frequency energy is because it consists of equal energy per octave. Remember, white noise is equal energy per frequency. Pink noise is equal energy per octave. Here's how white noise and pink noise sound side by side. An octave is a doubling of frequency. Therefore, the difference between 200 Hz and 400 Hz is one octave, just as the difference between 2000 Hz and 4000 Hz is one octave. But the octave between 200 and 400 Hz is only 200 Hz wide, while the octave between 2 kHz and 4 kHz is 2000 Hz wide. And this pattern continues. Higher octaves have a wider bandwidth compared to lower octaves. So if you're going to distribute energy equally to all frequencies, like white noise, you'll end up with less energy in the low octaves because they contain fewer frequencies. Of course, there are actually infinite frequencies in every octave when you consider the infinite frequencies between two whole numbers. But the point I'm trying to make here is that white noise will sound brighter with more energy in the higher octaves compared to pink noise that sounds darker with equal energy in all octaves. Let's visualize this with a multiband compressor plugin that allows us to listen in on the energy within a particular range of frequencies. First, let's look at pink noise, focusing in on a few one-octave bands throughout the spectrum. From 400 Hz to 800 Hz, 2 kHz to 4 kHz, or 750 Hz to 1.5 kHz, the meter shows the same level. Of course it does, because pink noise contains equal energy per octave. When I play white noise, the meter will show a greater level in those higher octaves, because there's more energy concentrated in the higher octaves relative to the lower octaves. Generally speaking, pink noise is more useful for testing and tuning audio systems. That's based on the fact that humans perceive frequency on a logarithmic scale. In Western music, there are 12 notes between 440 Hz A and 880 Hz A. There are also 12 notes between 880 Hz A and 1760 Hz, also A. We perceive these intervals as equal, even though the first interval is much smaller than the second when viewed on a linear scale. The difference between 440 Hz and 880 Hz is 440 Hz, while the difference between 880 Hz and 1.76 kHz is 880 Hz. And the interval between these frequencies is one octave in both cases. Like I said, humans perceive frequency on a logarithmic scale, which makes pink noise a better choice for measurements and references related to human perception of sound. This has a few implications that are important to us as audio engineers. First of all, it gives us an idea of what a well-balanced mix would look like on a frequency spectrum analyzer. If you try to make the frequency balance of your mix perfectly flat, like white noise, it may end up sounding a bit thin. Instead, you'll probably find a frequency balance resembling pink noise much more pleasing.
Okay.
Of course, I would ultimately recommend just using your ears to find a good balance based on the genre and your taste. If you need some help with that, use the link below to a free ear training guide at audiouniversityonline.com/eartrainingguide. Secondly, when making acoustical measurements or tuning sound systems, we generally use pink noise because our primary concern is usually human perception. Most audio measurements are reported in octaves or third octaves. Therefore, using a test signal with equal energy per octave, such as pink noise, is preferred. Take, for example, a sound isolation measurement. We generally care about perceived isolation more than absolute isolation, so we report transmission loss in 1/3 octave bands across the frequency spectrum, and because we report in octaves, we use pink noise for a test signal. One question I had was, how are white noise and pink noise generated? An acoustician friend of mine explained it to me this way. White noise is the random noise that's generated by electronic devices. If you connect a resistor to an amplifier and turn up the gain, you'll hear white noise. Pink noise also occurs in nature, such as the sound of a waterfall. He continued saying, if you're generating the noise by moving something with mass, like water, you'll get equal energy per octave, which is pink. If you're generating a random event without the inconveniences of inertia, for example, resistor noise, flipping a coin, etc., you get equal energy per possible outcome, which is white. Since white noise is trivial to generate electronically or computationally, artificial pink noise is usually white noise with a low-pass filter. In the next video, you'll learn how pink noise can be used to train your ears and your brain to identify frequencies, a skill that will instantly improve your mixing and critical listening. To watch that video, click the link that's on your screen now, and I'll see you over there.